All right, we'll, how many guys, what kind of meditation, hold your meditation book on. Hold your meditation book. Okay, that's the one y'all have.
I have these two right here.
All right, okay. We want you to make sure you always keep up on your book, your green one, and your. All right, those that have the green, hold it up, move it up.
Oh, wait a minute, what you call the green? They got their.
Is it this one or that's blue, the blue one?
Oh.
This one?
She got both.
I think that was the green, so that's okay.
I try to keep mine together, cause I leave one.
Okay, the green ones have a lot of information that pertains to healing and prayer and a whole lot of the ministry of reconciliation. Also, it also gives you a lot of prayers of deliverance, you know, deliverance from various addictions. Teaches you how to pray for people to get saved. Well, it has a prayer for salvation and prayer and a procedure to use for getting people filled with the Holy Spirit. Real simple, down to earth. And I think that you'll find a lot of information in that section two, specific information that deals with sickness. The first three chapters in section two deals with sickness. And I think that many times we that are not sick, let me ask you all a question. We that are not complaining with a serious illness, most of us got some kind of symptoms. Do you think it's necessary if you're not sick and don't plan on getting sick? Do you think that we should be focusing on meditating or anything about sickness?
Yeah.
All right, so your motivation would be to keep them away from you, or what would your greatest motivation be for meditating consistently on God's provisions to heal you if you are not sick? What would be your greatest motivation to meditate on something like that when you don't really feel the need for it?
When I need it, for whether it's for me or for somebody else, I need it to be already in my heart.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, well, do you need it for you or somebody else?
I already got it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But
listen,
you're not going
to
put that word.
Okay. Yeah. All right, now, what, do we have some, are we supposed to, all people supposed to have a ministry of our healing?
Yes.
I know we call to get people saved, but are we called to get people healed?
Yeah, mm-hmm. He
said
he went on the cross for that.
Greater works than he did, so that would be what he did.
Yep.
Can you remember scriptures that will bear you out on that? That it's God's will. I mean, we're supposed to be soul winners. We're supposed to be also healers. We're supposed to lay hands on the sick and deal with the sick and those oppressed and demon possessed. Alright, give me a scripture that shows that we are to be very righteous in the sick.
Mark 16:15-18.
What does that deal with?
It says, and he said unto them, well, these are Jesus' words, read in my Bible. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Mm-hmm. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Mm-hmm. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover.
Okay, that's one scripture that deals with
Mark 16:15.
The believer being commissioned to lay hands on the sick and to deal with the sick, to get them recovered from their sickness. Can you think of any other scripture that...
Isaiah 53:4-5.
Okay, what does that say?
Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for your transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that deals with sickness and sin, right?
Disease, yeah.
Sin, sickness. Okay. Mm-hmm. Jesus commissioned his disciples, I believe in Matthew 9 or 10, commissioned them to go and to preach the gospel, and he gave them the power and authority to heal the sick. He sent them forth, I believe, 10:1 or 9:1. Gave them power against, these were the 12 disciples, power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Okay, so is that still binding today, you think? Was that just for the apostles?
It's for today.
Okay, gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Okay, the same thing is in Luke 9, I believe. Luke 9 also. My case I'm making is that many times people feel that they don't need to deal with problems and circumstances that's not a part of their own experience, as if our ministry was only to ourselves and not for others. But Luke 9 also, he called the 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure disease. Okay, so we as believers, we have the power, we've been given power and authority over all of the power of the enemy. Luke 10:19, behold, I give you power to tread upon serpents and over all power. That's another scripture. Nothing by no means shall hurt you. Okay. So I believe that in order for us to be in that realm where these scriptures and these meditations would be something that we would be interested in, not to treat casually, I think that the meditations that we have directed you to are something that can really build your faith, can establish you, can fix your heart, get your heart established in that particular doctrine of healing. And also, it will enable you to carry out your commission to heal the sick as well. It will equip you in a lot of different ways. Now, any of you feel like the meditations have benefited you? If so, in what way? The meditations on healing. I'm just trying to get some feel, because you pass out a lot of things that can help people, and sometimes we don't know what the response is or how interested in those things we are, or whether you are making use of them, or whether you are applying them to your own, personal need. So how many of you have gotten some benefit out of the meditations on healing?
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
I shared one scripture in Psalm 107.
would say cousin of ours through marriage, who I sent the meditation book to. She lives in Texas. She's in her 70s. She lost her husband to several illness complications, what have you. And I noticed her when I went to the funeral of a family member a month ago. She was kind of leaning over. And I just told her about the meditation book, and I mailed it to her last week or something like that. But so even though she has the book, I like text her scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
So I text her Psalms 107:20. He sent his word and healed them and delivered
mm-hmm.
them from their destructions. And she said she loved that scripture. That was one of her favorite scriptures, and she'd have to email me her testimony regarding that scripture.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just something I felt that that scripture, something that came to me that I should pull out of the book, even though she has the book now.
Mm-hmm.
So you just never know what little something can trigger something. Oh yeah, that was my favorite scripture, or I need that scripture for this certain scenario, and this is how it, you know, helped minister. So I'm looking forward to see how she, you know, how she used that scripture, and I'll share it back with you all.
That's good.
Thank you.
That's good.
I really like it because on my job, I've gotten where people just pull me aside and ask me to pray for different things, but I found that when I pray for them, I also give them a scripture concerning it. So the more I have in my arsenal, the more prepared I am to do that. And that's what they say they appreciate. They say, you always give us a scripture to go with it.
Amen.
Okay, now on the scriptures, which ones that y'all did impact you more or got your attention more? The ones in which we had scriptures that were based on God's healing provisions, and then the confessions that followed each one, that was chapter 3,
mm-hmm.
right? Then on chapter 2, I had confessions of healing that were made throughout the Old Testament, New Testament too, I guess, confessions of healing, which we had only a scripture, but that scripture was in the form of a confession. And I believe that one of them was that I cried out to God, I cried out, and he has healed me. That was one of the ones. But there were several of many of the afflictions of the righteous, that God delivered them out of them all. That was a confession that David made. And David also said that he healeth all of our diseases, forgiveth all of our iniquities, and he healeth all of our diseases. These were actually confessions that were made from people that had experienced God's healing power. So we had a whole big section of scriptures that were dealing with confessions that people that had been sick, they gave a declaration of how God had delivered them. And there's another scripture, he has kept my feet from falling. How's that? He has delivered my soul from death,
my eyes from tears, and my feet from falling.
Okay, so all of these are scriptures that probably these confessions kind of relate to things that we experience on a day-by-day basis. So we can make those confessions, you know, our confessions. And that really brings a lot of consolation in the time of need. You have scriptures that you can draw from that really relate or identify with the circumstances that you are dealing with. So you are seeing what God says about your situation or your condition. So I just wanted to...
I have one.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I guess you've heard it so many times.
Mm-hmm.
2 Kings 20
mm-hmm.
of Hezekiah
mm-hmm.
when he was healed.
Was that
passage, 1 through 7.
Mm-hmm.
That is on the very first
Okay, what was striking about that?
Well, to me, the striking thing was, he put God's word before him. He prayed unto the Lord. And he asked God to remember how he had walked upright before him. And of course, he wept sore. I meditated that and thought about it, pondered it. It was it Hezekiah's tears that moved God? I don't think so. That's just me. I think it was his life that moved him, that he had walked upright before him, and he had done what was good in his sight.
Well, he poured out his heart. That's the thing that God, yeah, the sacrifices of God.
Right, not necessarily his tears.
A broken heart.
That was a result of the tears.
Broken heart.
Said he wept sore, but that was a outflow from what was in his heart. But he presented something to the Lord, his life. You know, he had a life to present to him. And he didn't have a ragged life, you know, and he could go to him with confidence, you know, although, like, I want you to remember, Lord, what I've done. I walked uprightly before you. That whole passage was really struck me.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's ironic. Today I was meditating. If y'all have this book here, I can just show you Hezekiah's life.
What page?
A little snippet of his life, the reason why
God, page
3 in this book here. I have a little snippet because I had, in this particular meditation, it says admonitions to hear, read, and meditate the Word of God. The reason I was reading this today was because these were our kings that made a commitment to the commandments and to seek God in their reign. They made commitments to the commandments and to seek God, a commitment to keep God's commandments, and also they made commitments to teach the law, obey, and to seek the Lord. That was King Jehoshaphat. The first one, King Asa's commitment. Then we have Hezekiah's commitment to keep God's commandments and to restore the service of the Lord. And the Bible says about Hezekiah, I like this, and he, Hezekiah, did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that David his father did. He removed the high places, break the images, cut down the groves, and break to pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had. He removed all of the idolatrous worship. He trusted in the Lord God of Israel, so that after him was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor any that were before him. For he clave to the Lord, and departed not from following him, but kept his commandments, which the Lord commanded Moses. And the Lord was with him, and he prospered whithersoever he went forth. And the second part there kind of explains him restoring all of the temple worship. And the last part is that he reinstituted the Passover, and he prayed for people to be healed during that Passover, and they were healed. And the part that stuck with me, and he commanded the people to give to the priests and to the Levites so that they might be encouraged in the law of the Lord. He put a lot of emphasis on people giving, and they did bring offerings in abundance. But the last part said that, and thus did Hezekiah throughout all Judah, and wrought that which was good and right and truth before the Lord his God. And in every work that he began in the service of the house of God and in the law and in the commandments to seek the Lord, he did it with all of his heart and what? Prospered. Now that might give you some insight why Hezekiah's prayer was heard and why God hearkened to him when he called God into remembrance to the works that he had been faithful in carrying out. So I think that's a good thing. Amen. You want to have grounds to stand on, and you can always call God into remembrance when you have walked. Well, this is what he said, I walked before you with a perfect heart. Would that be good that all of us got that testimony? I walked before the Lord with a what? Perfect heart. And I did those things that were what? Pleasing in your sight. So that will always cut the mustard. That will always give you
confidence
and faith to stand on when you meet with an emergency or critical situation. Okay, I was just kind of passing this over this evening just to see the commitment that you have made to deal with the meditations in the area of healing. I think it's so important that we understand that our call is not only just to preach the gospel or to go into all of the world and teach all nations, but we also to command, teach them to observe all of the things that he has commanded. And one of the things is that we are to heal the sick, cast out devils.
Yeah. Yeah.
The same works that Jesus did, we are to what? We are to do. I was going to, I got a whole lot of things I want to do, but I wanted to just read this before I get started. The price tag for miracles. This is from most of y'all are familiar with God's generals. Mm-hmm. They've got them, they've got four or five different volumes of all of these outstanding people of old that were used highly of God to get the kingdom of God established in our generation. Price tag for miracles. No, I'll just read this. When the last requirement was written down on the list, this was by a controversial evangelist called A.A. Allen. Some of y'all might remember his ministry. He had a good ministry, but very colorful, very dynamic, and he was criticized a lot by the denomination of the world. He was pretty flashy, but a whole lot of things circulated about him, but he did pay an awesome price to get the anointing that he had to heal the sick and to cast out devils and to establish the kingdom of God in his day. But it was a price tag that he paid. You know, you don't find too many of them that went on the 40-day fast, you know, like Jesus did. But he was the one that shut himself in, and he refused to come out of his closet until he had fasted and prayed, until he experienced a supernatural visitation, you know, from God to carry out the ministry that he carried out. But this is what he said. When the last requirement, God had placed 13 requirements on his life, in order for him to finally get to the point where miracles would begin to be manifested in his ministry. And this is what he said. When the last requirement was written down on the list, God spoke once again and said, this is the answer. When you have placed on the altar of consecration and obedience the last thing on your list, you shall not only heal the sick, but in my name shall you cast out devils, you shall see mighty miracles, as in my name you preach the word. For behold, I give you power over all the power of the enemy. All right, he continues to speak. God revealed to me at that time, at the same time, that the things that were hindrances to my ministry were the very same things which were hindering so many thousands of others. At last, here is the price I must pay for the power of God in my life and ministry. The price tag for the miracle working power of God. Here are the 13 things A.A. Allen said the Lord told him. He would see the miracle working power of God if he understood and did these things. Are y'all want to hear? Okay, all right, number one. He must realize he couldn't do greater quality miracles than Jesus. He must realize that he wouldn't be able to do greater miracles than Jesus did in quality. You know, I know that the Bible says, Jesus said, the works that I do, ye shall do works greater. But that didn't mean the quality of those miracles would be greater. There are some things that we can do today that Jesus wasn't actually directly doing them, but he's doing them through us today. That getting people born again, because the, you know, his redemptive plan hadn't been consummated. Mm-hmm. He hadn't gone back to his Father, so therefore he couldn't get us filled with the Holy Spirit until the time that God had appointed for that to be released in the earth. Neither born again. In fact, nobody could get born again until Jesus actually, amen, paid the price and ascended to the right hand of his Father. Okay? That was the first thing. Number two, he could walk as Jesus walked. You know, Jesus said the works that I, well, he said that, I believe in 1 John, that we are to walk even as he walked. We are to be perfect even as the Father is in heaven is perfect. So he could walk as Jesus walked. Y'all believe that we can walk as Jesus walked?
Yeah.
Yes.
With his help.
All right. Huh?
With his help.
All right, with Jesus in us, right? Yes. So we're not doing it alone. We have him walking along with us, and he's on the inside of us as well. All right, number three. He must be blameless like God himself is blameless. He must be blameless. In other words, you have to have a pure life. In other words, you can't be entertaining sin. You can't be living in sin. He must be blameless like God himself. Number four, he must measure himself to Jesus only, Jesus alone. You know, many times we measure ourselves by each other. The Bible says we're not wise. Well, I'm doing just as good as Sister Irene. she don't look no more spiritual than I do. Amen. You know, so we kind of measure ourselves, and sometimes we don't measure ourselves by the standard that Jesus set. Like, you know, even the apostles were great. You know, we can you know, measure ourselves by them. But our standard, ultimate standard, is Jesus.
Amen.
We're to walk even as he walked. Okay? He must deny his fleshly desires with fasting. You know, Jesus did this. He began his ministry with a 40-day fast. And the fasting discipline, it occurs all through the New Testament. You know, the apostles, Paul said he was in fasting, what, often? And they were fasting sometimes for many, 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 many days at a time. But that discipline continues throughout the the New Testament, even after grace and truth were established. All right, after self-denial, he must follow Jesus 7 days a week. After self-denial, he must follow Jesus 7 days a week. And number seven, without God, he could do nothing. That was one of the points God wanted him to know. Without me, you can do nothing. In other words, total what? Dependency. Total dependency. You know, our sufficiency is not of ourselves, but what? It's of God. We got to come to that point. All right, number eight, he must do away with sin in his body. You know, there are a lot of people have pet sins, you know, and that was one thing that God told him, you must do away with sin in his body. Now, this is what God's requirement was in order for him to have the miracle working power in operation. Number nine, he must not continue in shallow, pointless discussions. Number 10, he must give his body, W-H-O-L-L-Y, to God forever. In other words, sanctification, he must give his body completely over to God forever. Number 11, he must believe all of God's promises. Mm-hmm. Okay? He must believe all of, that was 11, but the remaining two guidelines were number 12, number 13, the remaining two were pet sins that God had pointed out by name. Alan never felt he could share them with anyone. Mm-hmm.
He never felt that he could share them with anyone.
There were two pet sins that he had to keep secret. He didn't ever disclose them because he felt like he could never, he couldn't feel comfortable in sharing them with anybody. So he never shared them.
Are those two there?
They're not here.
No, he didn't share them.
He didn't share them.
So God told him not to share those two? Is that what he's saying?
Well, then how could he work miracles if those were two sins that he couldn't share?
Yeah.
Well, he dealt with them personally. Yeah. He dealt with them personally, but he never let other people know
what
they were.
Was one is alcoholism.
Number nine.
Okay, number nine was, he must not continue in shallow, pointless discussion. All right, you know, sometimes we just be, you know, discussing stuff. Ain't nothing going to come out mounting nothing.
What was that number nine again?
He must not continue in shallow, pointless discussions. Okay, so.
Excuse me, Pastor. Someone is curious, what does pet sin mean?
That's secret sins that people are in love with. Sometimes they enjoy doing, and sometimes they just don't want to. Okay, now, the thing that got my attention here was that the miracle working power is for all of us. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. But there's a price tag that you have to pay. And I know that many times we are soft on some things, we're easy, you know, sometimes we are gung-ho on others. But sometimes, as somebody said that, we are hard on others, we're easy on ourselves. You know, sometimes we point a finger real easy, but you realize that how many point back at you?
Right.
The other four point back at you. Okay, so this really let us know that dealing with the flesh, you know, we felt like, many probably feel like we waste time working out lessons that focused all of that time on the works of the flesh. But you want to be familiar with things that really displeases God mm-hmm. in your life. Sometimes you have to reach beyond yourself and help others to identify things that really will cause you to be hindered and be limited in your ministry. And these are things that many times we don't feel like they are sins. It's difficult to convince people like us that certain things that we neglect and things that we just kind of are just kind of let go mm-hmm. and don't address. It's very difficult to tell believers that there are some things that they need to deal with in their lives. Mm-hmm. You know, it's kind of difficult.
And Pastor, some people mm-hmm. don't realize something is sin because there's something they've seen in their whole life.
Yes.
They thought that was okay mm-hmm. because maybe the church sister, church mother, or whatever done it. So they thought it was okay. I mean, it's out of ignorance. They just didn't know better. So that's why we have to learn from the Word, because we could be mm-hmm. led by somebody not meaning to mislead us.
Mm-hmm.
That is, you know, sins. Okay, now I'm going to turn to the page where we gave definitions of sin, page 60.
Are we on the blue book?
Blue book. And it might be good to study these definitions sometimes. And these definitions are four ways sin is described or defined in the Bible. These are scriptural definitions of sin. But no problem. I wrote down a whole lot of things that I felt like need to be addressed among believers, but I'm afraid to read them all.
Why?
You want me to read them all?
Yeah, read them all.
Well, you know, I know all of the scripture says that sin has been condemned in the flesh. They that are of Christ have already crucified the flesh with all of the lust. You know, these are scriptures that shows the legal position that we have as believers. Sin has been crucified, condemned, or rendered harmless or inoperative in the life of believers when they are born again, and if they actually take their place in Christ, these sins won't be able to operate. Okay, but I'm going to do the definitions first. Let me read the sins, huh?
Yeah.
Because I felt like I need to help y'all to, but.
Because it's like Sister Irene said, sometimes people be doing things they don't know. They really don't know.
All right, that's page 6. Let's do this first. Okay. Sin is the number one, is the transgression of the law. 1 John 3:4. That's the scripture. Sin is that whenever you transgress the law, the word of God, it is a sin. All right. All unrighteousness is what?
Sin.
The thing is almost right.
Still wrong.
You know, the grace of God really gives us dominion over it, so we don't have no excuse. We just really need to apply ourselves to the Word and really begin to build ourselves up and get beyond things, which are easy to do if we would apply the Word. All right, number 3, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Can anybody say anything about that? Mm-hmm. So whatsoever is not of faith. Mm-hmm. And that is one thing that Jesus called his disciples faithless and perverse generation because they weren't able to deal with that demonic situation that the Father brought to him. You know, this young man that had all of these epileptic seizures that jumped in the fire, and he just did a whole lot of irrational things. But they weren't able to cast them out because Jesus said this can come only by what? Fasting and prayer. And he called them faithless and perverse generation. In other words, Jesus looked at it as being what, something easy. He did say, which is easy for me to tell this man to rise up and walk, or to tell him
his
sins are forgiven. So Jesus considered these things as what, real simple. I don't know what has happened these 2,000 years, but that's what the scripture says. Whatsoever is not of faith is what?
Sin.
Whenever we operate in unbelief, and I think that we have to deal with that issue and ask God to forgive us. You know, I think even in praying the prayer of faith 2 and 3 times, and that kind of nullifies the first prayer, is that right?
And can I give you a couple of examples of that? The fear and worry. A lot of times when we enter in fear and worry, we're not in faith and we're sinning. So as we walk through our day, you know, even just for a brief moment, you have committed a sin, and then you step out of faith and you begin to fear and walk by sight. So we don't always view it in that point. If you just say, oh, then go back. Well, you sinned. It's time to confess that and get strong and go forth in that.
That's so true. That is really true. And I think that many times we take it so lightly and we don't realize that that's an infraction of God's word, and we don't ask forgiveness. We just keep on trucking. And many times, you know, that's one of the reasons why, you know, our faith is, you know, it's not working. Okay, that is whatsoever is not of faith is what is sin. And we need to address that spirit of unbelief and try to, what, get back on solid ground. I think that we need to utilize the power of confession or declaring. You know, once we pray for a need that is definitely in the framework of God's will, you know, like healing, finances, salvation, a whole lot of things we know is God's will because He plainly spells them out. Then we don't have to pray over and over and over for those things. We need to pray one time, and then from that point we can what? We can thank Him for them, or we can what, declare the word, continue to what, confess the word for them, or either you can always call God back into what, remembrance. Now, if you remember that Jehoshaphat's prayer, you know, even in the Old Testament, they understood that when they laid their case before the Lord, they knew that what praise and worship should what follow. They didn't continue to what, repeat the same prayer over and over and over and over. So whatsoever is not of faith is sin. You know, and that could be applied to a whole lot of different things that we contend with and that we confront on a daily basis. That is sin as far as God is concerned. Okay. Number 4, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Okay, now that would probably include a whole lot of things that we are not conscious of, or sometimes we are conscious of, but sometimes we just don't feel like doing it, or we don't have a mind to do it, or we have determined that we are not going to do it. That's not for me. That's not my ministry. That's my work. God didn't call me to do that. So there's a lot of things that we have to deal with, and some of y'all, I went through all of the instances in which we have studied in those paragraphs, which enumerates those various works of the flesh. I went through just every single one of them, and this is probably my summation of all of the things that I went through, I felt like we need to take a look at them. I'm afraid.
We keep dangling a carrot.
Yeah, we'll do this first, and then we'll go to it.
Okay, all right, number one.
Is this something you wrote down, or is it not in the book?
It's in the book. If I can point to it if you want me to.
Yeah.
What page?
Okay, the first one is page 56. This is the first one that I recorded.
Okay.
I'd like for you all to maybe get me to recognize this, because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Everything from that point goes downhill, even to a reprobate man. It lists all types of despicable works of the flesh in that section. And it concludes by saying, they which do such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them to do them.
So, well, action should be that.
Yeah, that do them, okay. Now, what I got out of that, the thing that we really have to watch, in our worship, you know, I always say that we work at our play.
And play at our
worship. Half-hearted or insincerity in worship. In other words, not fully yielding, not fully surrendering to God, and that opens the door for a whole lot of other things to transpire in your life. It opens the door for the enemy to get in. I think that the scripture, if I'm not mistaken, we were formed, or we were made, or we were created to worship God. That was the Bible says we are chosen generation, royal priesthood, a holy nation, called to show forth His what? The praises of Him that have called us out of darkness into this marvelous light. So, God wants all of us. He's very jealous, and He doesn't want to share His glory with what? No other. So He wants us to be wholehearted and to be fully absorbed in Him, and not one leg in and one leg out.
So this is one that you identify.
Yeah, this is what I feel like is a real hindrance to the work of the Lord today, is that
pleasure in that.
The real hindrance today is that I think that we need to be doing a whole lot of things in worship. The depth of worship that we should be experiencing, we're not ascertaining to it because of our flesh. We don't feel like it. Many times our minds and bodies and spirits are not engaged at the same time. And it takes a little work, it takes a little commitment, it takes you have to be kind of diligent and call your flesh to the attention, the fact that I'm supposed to be what? Giving God all that I have in worship. I think miracles, a good illustration would be probably all of those victories that were won in the Old Testament, Jehoshaphat victories. If you look up all of those words that they use for praise, they would be like yada, which would be wholehearted. They would be shabbat, which would be they shouted to the top of their voice. And then they use the word Tehillah. In all of those two or three verses in which the Lord set ambushment against those opposing, companies that were coming against them, those were the words that were used. Tehillah praise was the final word that was used when God set ambushment. And that was spontaneous. Singing. In other words, that was the highest dimension of praise that we often talk about. It was a high level of praise and worship that brought them the victory.
So you're saying that this scripture, when we fail to do that, you mentioned earlier you were going to point out to us some things that are sins that we probably don't consider a sin.
Yeah.
When we fail to do that, that you're then
it leads to a whole all of those other sins you see there. Mm-hmm. Everything went downhill when they knew Him as God. They didn't what? Glorify Him as God, and neither were they thankful. Now, how many of us worship God many times in the same way? You know, sometimes I have to really work at it. I say, man, I'm tired. I just don't feel like expending any energy this time. I just feel like soaking on somebody else and letting somebody else. Amen. But sometimes I think that we get too comfortable in the rendering of our praise and worship to the Lord. And that's one of the reasons why maybe on Sunday morning, maybe, you know, sometime they we hear them admonishing us, let's praise the Lord. I know that many times when we first began the worship service, everybody's not going to be in high gear to start it out. So my advice to the worship leaders is to be where God wants you to be, and start and light the fire and get the ball rolling. And someone said, if we catch on fire, the world will come to see us burn. So I think that at some point, usually people will get to a place where everybody is beginning to worship the Lord in the spirit to a certain degree. But I think that more fervency and praying in the spirit and pulling out of our heart to God is something that we need to really work on. And it might take, we're trying the meditations to bring us up to a point where we can flow better. I know other morning in our prayer meeting, we had we prayed in the spirit really fervently. I mean, everybody was, it was very fervent, but at the end, we had some Sister Precious. I told her to sing a song in the spirit, and we just called different ones to sing songs in the spirit. But this is something that many times we won't even consider. And sometimes when we address that issue of praying in the spirit, because Colossians 3:16 does say, that let the word of God dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, admonishing and teaching one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with melody in your heart to the Lord. Now, this is something that seemed to be foreign, and whenever it's brought forth, many times people say, I'm not used to this, we ain't supposed to do this, it's not for everybody. And sometimes it's something that we kind of reject or we kind of turn a deaf ear to. But everybody that can talk, you can sing. And it doesn't take a whole lot of skill to lift your voice and make melody in your heart to the Lord in psalms, hymns, and spirituals. It doesn't take a whole lot of skill to do that. But it's something that we back away from, because we never saw it in our church, our tradition. Yes. We don't see it, we're trying to introduce it, and people just not responsive that much to it. I mean, it's an option. That's the way we treat it. But this is the primary way we are to what? Edify one another. And that's very essential to the body of Christ in terms of us coming to the place where we are perfected. Amen. So that's the reason why I felt like there's a lot of attention need to be placed on the worship, wholehearted worship.
Yes.
And, I take my responsibility. I'm going to do it. I think that probably on Sunday morning, only 3 or 4 of us are here. That's probably everybody's probably singing then. almost in the
when
spirit.
When you mean on Sunday morning?
No, what I mean, early morning prayer. Oh, early morning prayer, I mean there's a real effort on the part of some prayer meetings of people that feel like God, you know, really have anointed them to do it. They want to do it, and once you get in that vein, you probably don't want to do anything more because it seems like you are ministering to the Lord. It's a perfect level of worship. In other words, it seems like you just get all absorbed, and you can just go into so many different dimensions of worship so easy, just by reflecting your voice. And sometimes you can scream it out, and sometimes you can do it soft. But you can make all types of melodies and say all kind of spirit stuff in the spirit, which is really exciting. And it's really something that brings you into a new, a higher relationship with God, because that stays with you all day, and you can just do it all the time as you go throughout your day worshiping God. So that was the premise that I was standing on, saying that I think that we need to really look at that area.
So these are from 21 on down through 32. That's what you were saying.
That was just the one, the worship aspect.
Okay.
Because
you haven't given us the other.
I haven't given you the other.
Okay.
The worship aspect led to all of those other degrading and abominable things.
Okay.
Okay. I don't know whether you would call it self-sparing, a sacrifice evasion, not fully surrendered, not persevering beyond our comfort zone. I don't know how you would want to frame it, but I feel like that is something that really hinders the cause of the gospel from being probably more effective. Okay, number two, anybody want? Okay. Number two, everybody ready for that?
Yes.
All right, let's just stop that. But, you know, once you fix number one, probably everything else will fall in place. Once you fix the mainest thing.
You know, sometimes, like on Sunday mornings, when worship service, the worship portion, if it must, begins, like you said, some might not be in it at that moment.
Right, right.
And what I've observed, you know, as Candy and others have said, is, you know, it has to be in your heart. And what's in your heart comes out.
Mm-hmm.
And if you observe some of the worship singers, as an example, some of them look like they're just really, you know, into the word and ministering and just bubbly, and it flows out into the audience.
Mm-hmm.
And for you not to grasp that, and it's kind of like sneezing is contagious. You know, once you see that, you're like, oh yeah, I'm in there with you. You know, I can feel that spirit because I can feel it in them and see it on their faces. You know, you can't be saying, yeah, I'm happy, excited, and you know, God has done this, and you're looking like, oh yeah, God is excited, God has done it. You know, but I see that manifested in their outward confidence, you know, motivates me even more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not that I'm waiting on them to do that,
because
I already come in with myself of where I am, and what I need to do that day. But when I see some of their faces, it just gets me going.
Some of their faces, not all of their faces.
What do you say, Tia?
Oh, I just say she said some of that.
She said some, not all.
I mean, you know, as a whole.
I think you have a point. I think that calls out the need for those in worship. They really need to make a commitment to do meditations, pray in the spirit, sing in the spirit. They really need to. and Bible studies that we're doing now, they need to be privy to this. They need to be in on this. And when they show up and they don't have all of this information at their disposal, then I think that it kind of puts them at a disadvantage. That's the reason why I think that those in praise and worship, they should be really dedicated and committed to doing the word and to the meditation, the praying of the Spirit, and the not only that, but there are some other things that we are going to mention tonight in terms of in the area of strengthening the hands of those in need. In other words, reaching out. There's no way we can have the life that we need if we don't minister life to others. And that is probably the biggest area of neglect that we have in the kingdom of God. Failure to minister, to reach out to others with life, with the word, in order for that life to be manifested in a greater measure in us. That is probably one of the biggest failure that we have as believers. So let me just go further. I would say number two on my list would be, I'm gonna see which one I want to say. I got a whole bunch of them here. Okay, I'm going to start with this. I would say lack of boldness, and that would probably be under the area of fear. Okay, the reason why I pointed to that, because remember when the apostles were approached by the rulers, when they were ordered not to speak anymore in the name of Jesus, and the man at the gate called Beautiful had been healed, a miracle had occurred, and Jerusalem was all stirred, tore up over it, and the king, the priests and all of those leading authorities in charge, they were very envious and jealous, and they really wanted to get rid of Jesus. And they were ordered, they wanted to get rid of the apostles, so they put him in jail, and then eventually they were released from jail, but they were ordered not to teach anymore or use the name of Jesus anymore. And they said, we shall obey God rather than what man. They refused to be quiet about it, but they went to their own company. See, the priests were mad, and all of the people that had seen the miracles, they were rejoicing. So it really got the leaders full of envy, and they got really serious about getting rid of them. But they got together and prayed. Let me just show you there. They got together and prayed, and what they prayed for is the same thing that we should be praying for. Acts 2:38. Because I think that like Shabbat, or praising God out real loud, or praying, or singing in the Spirit, I think that many times people are fearful of doing that. And I think that boldness is the thing that holds them back. The lack of boldness. They don't want to be. They don't want to take a leap in the dark, I guess.
They don't think they sound good.
Yeah, that's good. They don't think that they sound good. They might. Okay, but here is the scripture here, 4:4, Acts 4, 29. I'll start there. And now, Lord, behold thy threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word. That's what they prayed for. By stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of the Holy Child Jesus. Mm-hmm. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, mm-hmm. and they spake the word of God with boldness. Mm-hmm. So let's keep on. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. You know, that was the spirit of liberality there, the spirit of giving. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Then it goes on. But that shows that they lifted up their voice, verse 24, and when they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord, and this is when their prayer started. They called God's attention to the fact that he was God and yet made heaven and the earth and all of that. If you would notice that they lifted up their voice with their voice to God with what? One accord. Mm-hmm. They lifted up their voice. I mean, they were just shy, timid, weak-kneed, jelly-backed, half-hearted. And that was the thing that really got my attention. And then the Bible says in the 29th verse, they prayed for boldness, mm-hmm. that when they speak the word, amen, that signs and wonders would be done. And they prayed and they played until the place was shaken. And they played until the place was shaken. All right, in order for the place to shake, it had to be a high degree of fervency there.
Yes.
Okay. So,
but Pastor, there was a need there.
Mm-hmm. That was a need there.
There was an urgent need.
So we got to feel.
It was just like when we were down here eating dinner,
mm-hmm.
and we heard about Sister Dorothy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. and there was a fervent prayer mm-hmm. that went up because mm-hmm. there was a need.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know?
All right.
And maybe that fervency doesn't just come on an ordinary day. You know, but when there's a need, I mean, then that fervency comes just like adrenaline, you know, it just kicks in. Yeah.
All right, it kicks in, it definitely will kick in. But I was also looking at the fact that when the fervency that we probably need needs to be a sustained fervency, because things are very critical all around us now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, with what we have dealing with nationwide, what we're dealing with what locally, all around us, all types mm-hmm. of circumstances that could really bring a lot of turmoil, a lot of distress, a whole lot of destruction. I mean, we could be annihilated completely. If you've heard all of the prophecies that has been given in times past of men that were highly used of God, one in particular that probably you have heard about, like 90 American cities, this was a prophecy that was given maybe 30 years ago, that were launched from out of space, 90 American dates, and the name of the cities were enumerated. And it's been many, well, even the Bible, I mean, going through the Bible, we know that every major city is going to fall eventually. Mm-hmm. Everything as we know it today is going to what? Eventually be destroyed. And we do know that the Bible, and Isaiah, and a lot of all those Old Testament scriptures where these men could see things coming hundreds and thousands of years ahead of time. Even speaks about the cyber warfare, in which all of the passages and all of the things that alert us would be what? Completely what? Closed, wiped out. And so there are a lot of references to destruction, in America, you know, this is something that we have heard for years and years and years, and even in the Bible, we have pinpointed a lot of the things that we hear in the news today about Russia. And that's a real cruel nation. And the Bible doesn't spare any pain about how cruel and what their evil intentions are. So there is a reason for us to be really dead serious about our relationship with the Lord, our fellowship with the Lord.
Okay, so you were pointing out initially, you said you were going to point out some things that the brethren don't consider sin. And we went to Romans, you point that out.
Okay.
Failed to glorify. The second one, you just said that we don't strengthen, reach out.
Well, I mentioned, I just finished boldness.
Right, boldness.
I think the boldness issue, it carries over in terms of reaching out. Many times we don't know how people are going to respond. We don't like to warn people. We don't like to instruct them. We don't like to deal with them.
So when we fail to do that, you're saying that's a sin, you're saying.
Well, when the Bible tells us plainly in so many areas that we are to warn saints, we are to warn the backsliders, we are to warn the lukewarm, we are to warn even people that are going, moving ahead with the Lord. We're to warn all people, and we're to remind people of things that God has told us that we should be doing. We're to consistently. Now, if you want me to get into those scriptures, I have those written too.
Oh, we got about 10 minutes.
Okay. Warning and exhorting. Warning and exhorting. Warning and exhorting. We are to speak to people about things that probably they realize, or sometimes they don't realize. We need to call their attention to what God has said about things that, because God is saying this, he said, they that do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. I mean, he says that over and over. Then the other thing God says is that I'll spew you out of my mouth if you what? Lukewarm. Now what does that mean? Will you be lost? If you, probably will if you don't repent and get it right. Then the Bible also mentions about the unprofitable, you know, the word becoming unprofitable. In other words, things that choke the word out, you become unprofitable. The unprofitable servants were what? Cast out into what?
Out of darkness.
Out of darkness. So these are things that we have to really call to people's attention, but we don't just point out the doom or the judgment that they will experience, but we also to give them the direction that God wants them to go. We need to give them instructions as to how to turn things around. That's their responsibility. Now, I would feel bad if somebody, if my brother or sister in Christ, saw me faltering, saw me in sin, and didn't come after me. Didn't warn me or didn't try to help me in some way.
Sometimes people tell you where to get off.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, they will. You know, you
yeah, they'll tell you maybe where to get off, but.
But I guess it's the way you do it.
Yes, the spirit that you do it in. Okay, let me just go to that scripture again. I want you to see this. Like 2 Corinthians 5. You know, things as simple as sharing Bible verses with people that could benefit them is something that I don't think that you would face too much opposition. 2 Corinthians 5, 4, 5, this is a real good scripture. I said 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians?
2
Corinthians. 5, 10 or 1, 5, 10. Verse 11. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your conscience. Okay. Now, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Now, that is referring to verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he had done, whether it be good or bad. Mm-hmm. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. In other words, that is showing that every believer have to appear before the judgment seat of Christ, mm-hmm. and they have to give account of all of the things that were done in their bodies, whether they be good or what, bad. Mm-hmm. All right, knowing this, the terror of the Lord, the judgment of the Lord, and how they're going to have to confront all of their deeds, our duty is that we do what? We persuade men. Mm-hmm. Is it right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Verse 14 says, for the love of Christ, what? Constraineth us. Because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all what? Dead. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. So living unto ourselves and not, I got some much stronger scriptures that deal with the spiritual neglect that exists in the body of Christ. I have some other scriptures that I always, okay, this is, you might want to write this down. Romans 14, 19, let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace and things wherewith one may edify another. That is one scripture. Let us follow after the things which make for peace and things wherewith one may edify another. Then the Philippian scripture that I always refer to, it says, look not, Philippians 2, verse 4 and 5. Look not every man on his own things, but every man on his own things. Yeah. But every man on his own things. But every man also on the things of what? Others. Everybody see that? Mm-hmm. Okay, there are a lot of scriptures like Galatians 16, you might want to write that down. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them of the household of what?
Galatians what?
Galatians
6:10.
16. There are a lot of scriptures that we'll take time sometimes and go over when we begin to focus more on loving in deed and in truth, the thing that assures our hearts and gives us confidence and boldness in the presence of God and also at his coming, we will also have the same boldness and confidence. Boldness and confidence only come through loving in word, loving in deed and in truth. I mean, you really, the Bible says, have fervent charity one to another. And we don't have all of, we don't have time to read all the scriptures, but.
It's all from 10 now.
Okay, I've covered two or three. Sincerity in worship is what we want more of, right?
Yes.
And we need a lot more, what, boldness? In worship, boldness in what? Reaching out and ministering to others. And the Bible says the fearful and the unbelieving is going to what? End up in the lake of fire. So we got to get past fearful because God has not given us the spirit of what?
Fear.
But of what?
Sound mind.
Okay. How many dimensions? A worship thing, what else?
Lack of boldness.
Mm-hmm. And I would say the neglect of love. The neglect of acting in love. and it covers a wide range of things. It covers warning, admonishing people, encouraging people, calling them or connecting with them, and trying to build them up, edifying them. And these are the things that we want to focus on in order for us to be able to overcome the works of the flesh, which would cause the judgment of God to come upon us and the works of God to be hindered. The works of God to be hindered. Okay, so we got a long ways to go. We got a lot of information. I wanted to talk about the focus that we should have on prayer when it comes to believers. There's a strong focus in this book that tells you exactly the areas, the most critical areas that we should be praying for believers to be perfected in. The most critical areas. So all of that is going to be coming up. I'm just going to take my time and put all of these things I'm going to say in lessons, so you have to work them out and really learn it and share it with somebody else. Make it real easy, then you won't be afraid to share. All right.
I'm not scared.
All right, God bless you. Let's have a word of prayer. And who wants to lead out in prayer? Let's see where the bowl is at.
Well, we just thank you, Lord, for another day. And we're able to come before you, Lord. We give you all the honor and the praise, Father. For you're the God that loveth us. Father, we thank you that your word that went forth, that it should take root in our hearts and produce those fruits that are like unto you. So God, we thank you. In the name above every other name, the name by which every man, every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess, that Jesus Christ is Lord, we praise you. Thank you.
Amen. Amen.